I know I'm late, and everyone has already discussed this, but if I'm talking about Bridgerton now, I might as well share my take too. Hi, I'm LadyJenevia. I'm currently working on doing more in-depth videos about Bridgerton Season 2, but as you can guess by the title, today we will be taking a brief visit back to Season 1. I recently went and read the first Bridgerton book, The Duke and I. I have adopted a firm policy of not reading the books before I watch the seasons. I want to know as little as possible before watching a new season, and then I can read the source material afterwards so I can have both perspectives of how a season comes across with or without the knowledge of the source material. So even though I have been avoiding as much as I can about book 3 onward, I figured I might as well go back and read the first one since I've already seen season 1. And now I have some things to say. This is probably a good time to do an official verbal disclaimer. I really appreciate the comments I get from fans of the Bridgerton franchise on the videos that I make about the show, but I would respectfully ask that none of you say anything about any of the books that have not been adapted into seasons yet. I've already seen more than I want to, and I don't want to know anymore. I want to be surprised on a first watch of a season. But I decided to go back and read the first book since I've seen the first season, and the books are really short, so they're quick to read. They don't take long to finish. Now that I have the perspective of both the show and the book, I figured that since I haven't really shared a lot of my opinions about season one, probably because I don't have as many opinions on it compared to season two, it seemed like the right time to address the most discussed controversy of the season one plot. I'm going to quickly recap what happened in the show, what happened in the book, and then offer up how I personally would have changed the material when adapting it from book to screen. I'm really interested in the adaptation process because one of the stories I'm trying to outline is for an adapted screenplay, so I'm using this as a creative exercise of sorts in order to practice how to efficiently mine the layers of characters, their arcs, a dramatic narrative, but also how to adapt source material in a way that is updated to the sensibilities of today's world. I'm assuming that if you clicked on this video, you are already familiar with the story from Bridgerton season one and the controversy around it, but just in case, I will offer up a warning that this controversial storyline does deal with matters of consent being violated, so if that subject matter, essay, if any of that is something you don't want to go anywhere near, that's completely fine. Look after yourself and your well-being. I will be doing plenty of other Bridgerton videos that are not about that incident, so you can just subscribe and come back for the next video. I was aware of this incident going into my first viewing of season one. I had seen videos reviewing and discussing this season before I actually sat down to watch it for myself, so on the offhand chance that there are any people wandering into this space without having watched the show, I will give a brief overview of what happened on the show and also how it's different in the book. Simon and Daphne get married under the out-of-context information that he cannot give her children. She interprets this to mean that there's a medical issue on his part. In actuality, he does not want to have children, so whenever they are together, he removes himself from the situation so he can finish the job somewhere that is not her situation. When she finally figures out what he's doing, she takes control during their next encounter. She gets on top and he says wait twice, but she does not wait and he finishes the job without removing himself from her situation. How are we feeling about me tiptoeing around using graphic language? Don't blame me, blame the insufferably puritanical censorship algorithms of this website that I have to abide by. They have an argument, a falling out, and eventually they work out their differences and reconcile in time to give the audience a happy ending before the final credits roll for that season. This was, without a doubt, the most controversial thing about season one. That's why I heard about it even though I hadn't even watched the show at that point. The other main point of critical feedback was about the clumsy attempt at addressing systemic racism within the show's universe. They made it seem like interracial dating in the monarchy solved systemic racism in the Bridgerton universe. Interesting hypothesis. How does that work out in real life? The main plot point we're discussing in this video received significant backlash because it was a violation of consent without doing enough to flesh out how wrong this was. They tried to frame it in the narrative as an eye for an eye type of situation where in her mind she was retaliating against him for violating her trust, but the severity of her retaliation was far too much, and in particular, this story is supposed to be first and foremost about romance and escapism within romance. There's drama in all of the seasons, but it's never that type of drama. There is room to address this type of subject matter in fiction in a broader sense, but you have to handle it with care and sensitivity instead of brushing over it like it's just another fight for a couple to work through. The scale of this violation? Far too much for your show's premise, and far too much for it to be happening specifically between your main couple of the season that the audience is meant to be rooting for. If you go looking for discussions among book readers, book fans, a lot of them tend to say that the way this was done was far worse in the book. I'm not going to read the entire transcript of that scene because I would consider it to be far too excessive for the purpose of this video. I don't think it's necessary in order to get my point. You can, of course, go read it if you would like to get the full picture, but the TLDR is that Simon came home drunk and he fell asleep in her bed and he was biologically ready to go, so she started to make moves on him, they start hooking up, and then she does more or less what we saw her do in the show. If I had to speculate, I think the people who made the show and had to figure out how to adapt the material would have thought to themselves, well, you can't have her making moves on her husband when he's come home drunk. I don't know how much he would have sobered up by the time they started hooking up in the book. Perhaps there's some type of formula you could use to try to estimate, well, if he comes home at this time with a blood alcohol level of such and such, and then he falls asleep for this many hours, and his body size is this, and his tolerance level is this, and so on and so forth, then his blood alcohol content would be such and such. But we as readers of the books, we don't have enough information to figure that out for ourselves. And regardless of whether or not he had an unspecified amount of alcohol in his system, the main issue at hand is that Daphne is violating his bodily autonomy and she's violating his consent. Presumably, the people who were breaking the story for adapting it to television had good intentions, but the execution? Not great. If you look at a skeletal version of the season one story, you strip out the details and simplify it to the main beats. So you have items on a list such as their meet cute, blossoming connection, inciting incident for the forced marriage, the marriage itself, the honeymoon, and where those events take place in the episodic running order. This is the point in the story where they have to have one final big dramatic conflict, one final hurdle for them to overcome before we get the final payoff of them affirming their love for one another and leaving the audience happy and satiated with the story in its entirety. Before I present how I would have changed the material for the adaptation, we need to unpack some of the specifics for each of these characters because it's important information to be able to understand what else is going on in the dramatic narrative for your leads so you can contextualize what goes into crafting the final conflict. It needs to be the culmination of what these two have already been struggling with in prior episodes. So we can start with Simon. Simon is shown to have struggled with a stutter as a child. This was the reason his father rejected him, because his father regarded him as unworthy of inheriting the title of Duke and was extremely cruel in his rejection of him and the way he treated him for having a stutter in the first place. Simon is holding on to that rage and resentment. When his father was on his deathbed, Simon visits him, and even though his father has finally come around and decided to happily pass the torch to Simon, Simon isn't having it. He swears to his father that he will never have children, so that legacy that his father cared more about than Simon will die with Simon. But he doesn't tell Daphne about any of this. Though these two are shown to develop a really sweet and genuine friendship with each other that blossoms into a deeper romantic connection and passion for one another, they get married without Daphne knowing anything about Simon having struggled with a stutter before, or his traumatic relationship with his father, or the vow that Simon made to never have children. Now we can switch over to Daphne's material. She, like all the other young ladies of the Ton, is on the hunt for a husband because it's a regency setting, which means systemic misogyny against women, as they are not granted financial autonomy and have to rely on men for that. Everything I already mentioned in my previous Bridgerton video about season 2. One of the recurring things they put into Daphne's material as an individual character is a journey of self-discovery in regards to her sexuality. They have the more fun ways of playing that out in the story, where Simon is the one that tells her how to, well, enjoy herself, take matters into her own hands. But they also show the more alarming side of it, where she has received no real sex education. When her mother is meant to finally tell her how things work, because she's finally going to get married and have a wedding night, her mother completely fails to offer her any meaningful information or insight. This is a really interesting topic to have in Daphne's storyline, because it's a great opportunity to do a well-deserved, scathing indictment of the puritanical misogyny that oppresses women under these hypocritical double standards of Puritanism. We see men on the show being free to go in and out of brothels, adult parties, and indulge in that type of hedonism as much as they please, and they will not lose any value on the marriage market or as people in general. But if a woman is caught in a moment of passion with a man whom she has been dating, they have to get married, or no respectable man will ever want to marry her. That conversation Daphne has with her mother later on in the show is something I really enjoyed watching, because she's telling her mother, "You failed to educate me about something that was important for me to understand." And at that point in time, Daphne is in the thick of her massive falling out with Simon because she essayed him. She didn't know about the birds and the bees. She didn't know what caused a woman's pregnancy. So that lack of education meant she didn't know that Simon was intentionally removing himself from her situation. Simon is also the only man she's ever been with, so she has no other experiences to compare with. With the exception of that one morally reprehensible thing that Daphne did, everything else we have to work with in this part of her story is very good. There's a lot of great material to work with. So this brings us to my proposal of how to alter the material in the adaptation process to maintain the dramatic conflict, but do it without having it cross a boundary of violating Simon's consent, as was done in the book. I'm actually surprised that the show failed to come up with this solution, because I think it's a pretty simple one, and I also think it's an obvious choice in how to fix the material. Being that Daphne's trajectory sees her learning more about her sexuality, you don't actually have to change the scene of them hooking up. You can have her roll them over and take control of the situation, and he can be surprised by this because it's something she's never done before. The only thing you have to change is she needs to not know that he's always deliberately removing himself from her situation in order to try to prevent a pregnancy. But in that moment, you can have Simon be so swept up in the passion of the moment that he just doesn't remove himself from her situation, but he does still get upset afterwards, and then he won't explain to her why he's upset. So you have her getting really stressed out because she doesn't know if she's done something wrong, and she hasn't done anything wrong in my version of how to adapt this material, because she doesn't know about the vow he made to his father. So what does she do? She starts chatting with the workers the same way we saw her doing in the actual show, and that's how she can find out more about the birds and the bees, and then she gets mad at Simon because he had withheld information from her. It's completely in character for Simon to be bad at communication when it comes to him opening up about that part of himself, because that was how he was in the show. He was never the one to tell her about his stutter or how horrible his father was, or the vow that he made to let the title die with himself. It's an extremely simple solution. You only had to change the order of things the show actually did, but the final result would have been that your main girl didn't violate her husband's consent and bodily autonomy and make us, the audience, feel very weird about how much or how little we are invested in that season's core love story. You still get to follow the trajectory of Daphne becoming more informed about sex education and also more comfortable and empowered in her sexuality. You still get to have Simon learn that he needs to let go of his anger and resentment towards his father and live for himself and the woman that he loves instead. In my version, you could still have them get mad at each other, but they will learn to work through it. And this was already something in the canon that they're not always great at communicating. They were making themselves miserable from the engagement through the wedding because they were both assuming that the other person felt forced into the marriage without actually feeling genuine romantic affection for the other person. But then they and we as the audience got to have this lovely catharsis when they finally open up to each other about their feelings and resolve the issue and also consummate the marriage. You could have done that again, but you producers or writers or whomever decided that that was the way they were going to do the storyline of season one, they made a mess of it all. And even now, I don't fully know how I feel about them as a couple. It's a pretty dire mistake to make as storytellers when everything else was really sweet. But it goes to show that a lot of work goes into the adaptation process, or even if you're writing an original screenplay or an original novel, there are a lot of moving parts to keep track of. And when you also factor in that the original book was focusing largely on two characters, whereas the show made the creative choice to expand the focus into more of an ensemble piece, it means you have even more plates that you have to keep spinning at once. I do think that making the show an ensemble piece was the right choice, but is there a chance that it meant that certain things in the story were not considered as thoroughly as they should have been? Perhaps. Were they concerned about not making too many changes to the original source material because they didn't want to inflame a potentially hostile response from the fans of the books? Perhaps. There's really no way for me to know for sure what exactly led to the decision to do it how they did it on the show. Maybe they thought that removing the alcohol from the equation was enough to dull the edges of a plot point that had already aged like milk. But me personally, I would like for this negative incident to be spun into an opportunity for learning so that if anyone else is looking to write their own books or screenplays, that we can learn how to be more creative and imaginative and empathetic in our approach to storytelling so that we don't have to have situations like these where you're seemingly unintentionally putting a romantic spin on consent being violated. I don't know if anyone else cares about approaching the uglier executions of the romance genre with this approach, but it's one that I've done before because I have my own screenplays I'm trying to outline, and sometimes my vision is for characters to do bad things, but it doesn't mean that you endorse those actions in real life. Fiction is a vehicle for using imagined, heightened realities to explore the human experience and broader themes. If I write a story where there is a group of organized criminals, it doesn't mean that I think organized crime is fine. That premise could simply be a way of serving a larger thematic purpose for the story I want to tell. But you did not click on this video to hear me workshop my own screenplay, so I will simply reiterate that if any of you are aspiring storytellers, I wish you well with drafting your outlines and filling in all of your details. I find that although art I enjoy can be a fantastic source of creative inspiration, there are also cases like these where something going wrong in fiction, something that I don't like the execution of, can also help me creatively because sometimes I see creative missteps like these as a problem or an equation that needs to be solved. And in order to do that, I have to take the machine apart. I have to look at all the pieces and find a way to put it back together again so that the finished result is something I like better. I know this video was a little bit different, but I figured I might as well share some thoughts about this since I just finished reading The Duke and I. Stay tuned for more Bridgerton videos in which I will, of course, be circling back around to season two, as it is a season I much prefer overall compared to season one for more reasons than just the fact that Anthony is a Bridgerton sibling who knows what consent is and he values it a lot. Like, comment, and subscribe so you don't miss any of what comes next, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!